when the rains came.
Welcome to Chemistry Tales. In the hollow. This is Tale 4.2. And we're going to give consideration to how we predict if when two atoms bond together, whether the nature of that bond is covalent or ionic. And we're also going to begin to predict structures of molecules using Lewis dot structure procedures. Okay, to begin, we are going to think about how we predict if a bond involves ionic full exchange of electrons, or if it's going to be covalent bonds sharing of electrons. So bonds can be of these two categories, ionic, and once again, ionic bonds result when one atom completely gives up one or more electrons to the other atom, forming a cation and an anion, and an attractive force exists between those species. So when you combine sodium and chlorine, sodium gives up an electron to chlorine, we form the ions, that attractive force creates the ionic bond. Some bonds are covalent in nature. Covalent bonding involves the sharing of electrons. Two atoms come together and they each are going to contribute an electron and they're going to share electrons. And the two atoms can share one pair of electrons or they could share two or three pairs of electrons. And the reason that they come together and do this is to achieve a stable noble gas configuration. If you will remember, noble gases are extremely stable and they have 8 valence electrons around them. When we look at covalent bonds, we categorize them as either pure covalent. This is what we call equal sharing. And what we mean by equal sharing is the pair of electrons that's being shared would spend about the same amount of time around each of the two atoms involved in the bond. Keep in mind, electrons are constantly moving throughout the orbitals, okay? So a pure covalent bond, the pair of electrons spend the same amount of time around each atom. In a polar covalent bond, that is unequal sharing. So what happens then is one of the atoms is better at attracting the electron to itself, and thus the pair of electrons spends more time around one of the atoms and less time around the other atom. So that's unequal sharing. And we can predict if a covalent bond is going to be pure or polar, and we can predict if a bond is going to be ionic or covalent by looking at a new property we haven't talked about yet named electronegativity. Electronegativity is a little bit different than electron affinity, but it's somewhat similar. Okay, so we have a new property that we want to give consideration to. This is electronegativity. It was discovered by Linus Pauling, very famous scientist. And we represent this property by Greek letter chi. It looks like an X. And this is the ability of an atom to attract electrons to itself in a bond. So as we discussed in the previous slide, we can have ionic or covalent bonds. And so this is the property that is a measure of how well an element attracts electrons to itself. All right, so here are values of electronegativity for all the elements in the periodic table. The scale is based upon the element fluorine. Fluorine is the most electronegative element. it does the best job of attracting electrons to itself in a bonding situation. We assign the value of 4.0 to fluorine, and everything else is relative to that, and everything else is smaller than 4. So the nature of the bond is predicted by the difference in the electronegativity of the two atoms engaged in the bond. Ionic bonds are those that form when that difference in electronegativity is bigger than a value of 1.8. We are going to get a full exchange of electrons. It's going to be an ionic bond. For example, if you look at sodium and chlorine, the difference in their electronegativity values is a 2.1. A pure covalent bond is defined as one in which the difference in the electronegativity of the two atoms undergoing the bond is less than 0.4. So, for example, if you have two hydrogen atoms bonded to each other, each hydrogen atom has an identical electronegativity, so the difference is zero. That would be a pure covalent bond. A polar covalent bond would have a difference in electronegativity somewhere between 0.4 and 1.8. For example, when hydrogen bonds to chlorine, the difference in their electronegativity values is 3 minus 2.1, which is 0.9. So that would be a polar covalent bond in which the electrons spend more time around the chlorine than the hydrogen, because chlorine is a more electronegative element. Okay, in this next section, we are going to start drilling down on covalent bonds and the concepts of bonding and why atoms undergo a process in which they share electrons. Okay, remember that chemical processes are typically driven by stability. Atoms are going to bond in order to achieve a stable noble gas configuration. If you'll remember, the electron configuration of noble gases are very stable with the fully filled subshells. All right, a noble gas has a general configuration of NS2, NP6, thus a total of 8 valence electrons outside of the core. Okay, and just remember that bonding is going to occur with the electrons that are outside of the filled principal shells. And so valence electrons are those outside of the core, and they're going to be the ones that are used in bonding. So the octet rule. So atoms are going to tend to bond in order to get a stable octet, that is 8 electrons around themselves, just like a noble gas. Okay, so with that in mind, we need to keep in mind most elements are going to follow the octet rule. And so let's remind ourselves how many valence electrons are available for bonding for the different families in the periodic table. Group 1A, the alkali metals, have one electron in an s orbital outside of the core, so they have one valence electron. And there's the general electron configuration. The second family in the periodic table, 2A, the alkaline earth metals, they have 2 electrons in the s orbital, so they have 2 valence electrons. The third family in the periodic table that begins with the element boron, they have 2 electrons in an s orbital and 1 in a p, so they have 3 valence electrons available to bond with. And group 4A, which starts with carbon, It has two electrons in the s and two electrons in the p, so there are a total of 4 electrons available for bonding. And the family starting with nitrogen, they have 2 in the s and 3 in the p, so there's 5 valence electrons for all of those elements. Okay, the chalcogens, which is the family beginning with oxygen, they have 2 in the s and 4 in the p, so they have a total of 6 valence electrons. And the family 7a are the halogens, right next door to the noble gases. They have 2 in the s and they have 5 in the p, so they have a total of 7 valence electrons. Okay, now we are armed and dangerous. We're going to be able to predict the Lewis dot symbol for each of the elements in the periodic table. The Lewis dot symbol is going to help us predict how many bonds each atom is going to want to form to achieve its stable octet. So the rules, write the element symbol. Then you're going to place a valence electron on each of the 4 sides of the symbol. And we're not going to pair up any electrons until we have no choice. That's kind of Hund's rule, right? Okay, so lithium. First family has 1 valence electron. Beryllium has 2. Boron has 3. Carbon has 4. Nitrogen has 5. Now I have no choice. I got to pair one of them up. Oxygen has 6. 1 on each side, then pair up 2. Fluorine has 7. So 1 on each side, then I pair up 3. And neon has 8. And I should have left 1 off of fluorine. That's an error on the fluorine. There should only be 7 electrons around fluorine. Okay, the Lewis dot symbol is useful because it shows us how many covalent bonds we're going to need to form in order to get a total of 8 electrons around the atom. Because keep in mind, another atom's going to come in and contribute an electron. So once again, the octet rule, atoms are going to bond to achieve a stable octet, 8 electrons around each atom. There are a few exceptions to the octet rule, starting with hydrogen. Hydrogen only has 1 orbital, the 1s. The maximum number of electrons you can put around a hydrogen atom is 2, and the same is true for helium. Other elements further down in the periodic table can achieve what we call an expanded octet. This starts with the 3rd row in the periodic table. What happens with the elements in the 3rd row is we have empty orbitals. We have a full set of 3D orbitals that there are no electrons in. So that's a space that I can put extra pairs of electrons in. So any element bigger than atomic number 11, sodium, could potentially have more than 8 electrons around them when they form compounds. Okay, and now we're going to use our Lewis dot symbols as a tool to help us predict the structure of molecules and how many pairs of electrons, how many bonds are going to form between 2 atoms. So here's hydrogen with its Lewis dot symbol, and here's chlorine. Okay, they're going to come together and form a single bond and share a pair of electrons. Those 2 dots represent a single bond. Okay, the 2 atoms are sharing 1 pair of electrons. And I can represent that with the more traditional structure of the molecule. And notice that the chlorine has what we call 3 lone pairs of electrons that are not involved in the bonding. Okay, let's show the bond that forms between 2 fluorine atoms. Okay, the 2 atoms come together, they're going to share 1 pair of electrons. And structurally, I can represent it with the dash, the single dash, representing the single bond which is one pair of electrons being shared. Notice that the difference in electronegativity is zero because this is a pure covalent bond. For the previous example, hydrochloric acid, the bond is polar covalent because the two atoms have different electronegativity. Now, I can combine hydrogen with oxygen. Notice that oxygen wants two bonds, so I'm going to have two hydrogens. So now I'm going to bring in one hydrogen atom and then another. And so now I've got the structure of water. I have two lone pairs on the oxygen and two single bonds to the hydrogen atoms. And notice that the difference in electronegativity is going to be polar. When nitrogen bonds with hydrogen, notice that nitrogen's going to want to form three bonds. So we better use three hydrogens. So now we're going to get nitrogen with a single bond to each of three hydrogens, and there's one lone pair of electrons on the nitrogen atom. Okay, now that you're really good at predicting Lewis dot structures, let's think about when oxygen bonds to oxygen, to oxygen atoms. Notice that each oxygen atom is going to want to form two bonds to get eight electrons around. So what we find when two oxygen atoms bond, we get a double bond. They are going to share two pairs of electrons. And then each atom will also have two lone pairs of electrons around themselves. We represent a double bond with two dashes, as shown here. And there's the lone pairs of electrons on each oxygen atom. There's your double bond, representing the sharing of two pairs of electrons. All right, let's do another. Nitrogen. Let's consider what's going to happen when two nitrogen atoms bond with each other. Notice that each nitrogen atom is going to want to form three bonds to get eight electrons around. So these atoms are actually going to form what we call a triple bond. They are going to share three pairs of electrons. I can represent that with this symbol and the three dashes representing each of the three bonds. This is a triple bond. And then each nitrogen atom has one lone pair of electrons as well. So we're going to take what we've just learned and start predicting the Lewis structure of more complex molecules. Okay, next thing we want to do is really think about what's actually happening when a bond forms. We're going to have two atoms approaching each other, and they're going to share electrons. Well, remember, electrons are in orbitals. So when a bond forms, it involves orbital overlap. Okay, so let's think of the simplest molecule possible. Hydrogen. Two hydrogen atoms approach each other. There is a single electron in each of the 1s orbitals on each of the atoms. And the s orbitals are spherical in nature, so as those two atoms get close, their orbitals overlap. That region of space that is overlapping, that is the covalent bond. That is the common region of space where the two electrons are shared. We define the bond distance as that distance between the two nuclei on the hydrogen atoms. From an energy standpoint, let's consider what happens when the atoms are far apart and then when they come together. When they're far apart, the energy is a medium value. As they get close and we start overlapping the orbitals, it reaches a minimum. That is where they're most stable. That is where the bond forms. If you continue to push them together, the positive charges in the nucleus cause the energy to go way up, and that is very unstable. So that minimum in energy is right where the bond forms, and that distance is the bond distance for that single bond. Okay, now that we are thinking about bond formation as overlapping orbitals, we are going to distinguish between two kinds of bonds. We are going to define what is a sigma bond, Greek letter sigma. Okay, a sigma bond is one that involves direct orbital overlap. We call this head-to-head overlap. Okay, and the overlap occurs as the two atoms approach each other. The bond axis is the direction that they're approaching each other on. So in the previous case of the hydrogen bond with the s orbitals, that is an example of a sigma bond. Because as the two hydrogen atoms approach, the bond forms as the orbitals directly overlap each other. That can happen also with p orbitals if they are on the bond axis. We can have head-to-head overlap, a sigma bond, if the p orbitals are oriented as shown here. Now, in contrast, we can have what are known as pi bonds. Pi bonds are a result of what we call side-to-side overlap. And to illustrate what that involves, let's think about the p orbitals, okay? You have three p orbitals, one on the x-axis, one on the y-axis, and one on the z-axis. So if you have two atoms approaching each other, each with a set of p orbitals, okay? The p orbitals that are on an axis other than the x-axis can experience side-to-side overlap. So if they're on the y-axis or the z-axis, they can experience side-to-side overlap. That is known as a pi bond. So in review, if you have a single bond, it will always be a sigma bond, head-to-head overlap. If you have a double bond, one of the bonds will be a sigma bond and the other will be a pi bond. And if you happen to have a triple bond, you're going to have one is going to be a sigma bond, direct head-to-head overlap, and the other two bonds will be pi bonds, in which they're side-to-side overlap. Okay, and so we want to predict the kinds of bonds that are going to form for the following structures. We want to know if they're sigma or pi bonds and what the orbitals look like. So if two chlorine atoms are bonded to each other, notice that the valence electrons are in 2s and 2p orbitals. So the single bond between the chlorine atoms is going to involve the p orbitals. So as the two chlorine atoms approach each other on the x-axis, okay, the p orbitals overlap each other, and that's where the single bond forms. We have head-to-head overlap of those p orbitals. Okay, oxygen, we said, has a double bond, and then each have two lone pairs of electrons. So in that double bond, one of these is a sigma bond, the other is a pi. So like the chlorine, we have head-to-head overlap of one of the p orbitals. There's the sigma bond. And then the oxygen also have two more p orbitals. And we're going to have side-to-side overlap between one of those. There's your pi bond. So one sigma and one pi. We said nitrogen, N2, forms a triple bond between the two nitrogen atoms. So very much like the oxygen, Okay. Within that triple bond, there's one sigma, but now we're going to have two pi bonds. So the p orbitals overlap along the x-axis. That's head-to-head overlap. There's a sigma bond. Then there's two more p orbitals for each atom. There's the one on the y-axis, and here's one on the z. The one on the y-axis, there's the pi bond. And now here's the one on the z-axis. We have one coming out at you, okay? And now we can have side-to-side overlap within those p orbitals. So there's the second pi bond. So covalent bond formation involves orbital overlap, and it can be sigma or pi.